Awesome. Well, I'm sitting down now with Sam Maule. Sam, thank you very much for joining me here. You've come all the way from sunny Florida.
And it's beautiful outside.
Well, not quite beautiful outside, cool. but I love your enthusiasm anyway. That's wonderful. I've done a bit of a kind of a dig through your background, which always sounds quite sinister, I know, when I sort of start saying that in terms of where we're at. But you have one of the most varied backgrounds that I've ever seen, quite frankly. It's quite impressive. For starters, you pretty much lived on a submarine for 9 years. Like, talk me through this. What was the background? The USS Simon
Bolivar, George Washington of South America. Wow. Mr. Bolivar. I was desperate to get out of Detroit. So I grew up in Detroit, mm-hmm. which is awful. At 17, I joined the Army, believe it or not. I did 2 years as an infantryman in the Army. And if you are a smartass, you're just not, and if you ask why, that's a really bad way to go into work. So that was my first job. I was horrible at it. I had to make a choice. I either went back to Detroit or I did something else. So I thought, okay, the Army didn't match, so I'll do the direct opposite. So I went in the Navy and found out that I actually tested really well in maths, as we say in the UK, in my maths and science. And I went into the Navy, qualified on submarines, which is a really good fit for me because it's the most non-militaristic part of the military there is. Mm-hmm. It's really laid back, so it was a good fit. And you're supposed to ask why. And so I enjoyed it, I had a good time. And I'm short. So I fit really well. That's important.
No banging your head.
Not at all. I'm perfect for that. You know, 5'7" and under. So me, Tom Cruise, Dustin Hoffman, those guys. We did well.
It's an amazing, the idea that you're living in so far under sea a lot of the time. Like, how was that?
It's a thing mentally. I really do. I think it's something. I think astronauts are probably like that too, right? You know, if you or I, you know, they said, I want you to go to Mars and never leave and be stuck in that. I'd probably be okay. You'd probably go nuts. It's being able to take your mind or your brain and just occupying the time, finding something to do with.
I've got like a 2-hour commute home. I can barely deal with that. Never mind like being underwater for that period of time.
Yeah, and I have ADHD really bad. I don't know how I did it, actually, looking back. But I have absolutely no clue. I probably was horrible.
And you transitioned from that into Northern Trust Retirement Consulting. So this was, a very different shift. Like, what was the bridge between those two?
Well, my first job out of the Navy was as an HR manager for a Japanese steel fabricator in Northwest Georgia, believe it or not. And that was because of my QA background in the Navy. I knew QA really well because on a submarine, you either do it right or it sinks. So that's the QA program. Do it really right or everybody dies.
There's no fail fast.
Fail fast. Yeah. And they were trying to set up a good program at this company. So they hired me under the guise of an HR manager, which I lasted exactly 28 days,
wow.
by the way.
Okay.
And the president of the company brought me in, barely spoke English. And he said, Sam, you have no heart. And I thought, oh my God, I don't want to get fired 28 days in a job. But he said, we think you'd make a great QA manager. And what he meant was, I'm not empathetic. I didn't really show any empathy. So as an HR manager, I was horrific. But as a QA manager, I was really, really good because I was really, really focused.
I can't believe that. You know, we talked about this sort of before, but you have the reputation of being the nicest man in fintech and banking, right? You know,
I'm an asshole. It's the biggest bit of hype ever. I'm a jerk. I'm 50 years old. That was when I was.
You're not 50.
Yeah, I turned 50 in 2 weeks.
Oh, wow! You're never. You're making.
You've seen all
up.
My jobs, right? Do the math.
That's true.
That's a 30-year career. Yeah, I turned 50 in a couple of weeks, and I've changed a lot. I'm a lot mellower now. I actually like people now, or at least I fake it really well. Back then, I didn't. I was really anal and I was really focused. So
you're where I'm going to be in like 20 years.
Yes,
he'll
be a nice guy. And like the whole staff is laughing because they don't believe this. Yeah, your future is really bright.
Good.
I've mellowed as I've gotten older, definitely. But and I learned a lot. I learned a lot about making those mistakes. I was one of those when I went and I was in the banking side. I was the nut that would do 90-hour work weeks and 100, which as a banker is ridiculous. As an entrepreneur, it's a must, right? It's what we do, but it's what we love to do. I say we as if I have a company. I don't have a company, but it's the thought process.
Yeah, but it's the difference between doing something that you love and doing something that's a job, isn't it?
Exactly, and what I do now, I love. Yeah. So for me, it's not work. I get asked all the time, how are you doing all this stuff? Because I wear a lot of hats, and it's because I like it. It's what interests me.
Sure. So another stint there, and suddenly you pop up in England, in York. Yeah. What was the move there?
Well, every job I've had zero background in. I knew nothing about the Army, obviously. I knew nothing about the Navy. I knew nothing about steel.
So you interview brilliantly,
right? I con my way like you wouldn't believe in every job. So I went to work for TSIS. They were convinced I was a stellar programmer and project manager. I'm a good hacker. I'm a lousy project manager, because that's attention to detail, which the older I get, I lose. But again, I interviewed really, really well, and actually really enjoyed the job. And I was coming back and forth to Europe with TSIS. They were expanding into Europe about the time I was hired. And I was going back and forth, working with like Royal Bank of Scotland, Deutsche Bank, Santander, and others. And I was going so much, it just made sense for me to move over full time. And so my family, my kids were raised in York, England. My friends back in the States say I act very European, because I'm obviously very European in my views on life.
Are they using that as an insult?
Yes, 100%. Yes, that'd be like me telling you you're very French. Yes, it's an insult, which I don't care. But we really enjoyed it. We loved it, and we had a good almost 5-year run over here. So UK is like a second home for me. I love coming here. I mean, right before this, I went up and saw all my friends and what I consider family in New York. And the same with London. I've got so many friends here. So
cool.
I love it.
Well, and suddenly you're back in Florida. So you're back in Carlisle and Gallagher. You did your stint in London and York, and then suddenly you're back over there in the sunshine again.
Yeah, that was my penance. Florida's fine. I like it. It's a lot different than the UK. But working for a consultancy firm, first time, and it's funny that I worked for a consultancy firm, in all honesty, because I hated consultants. When I was on the flip side, when I was a banker, when I worked at TSIS and others, consultants didn't really impress me. I was one of them, right? Why should I pay you all that money for what you do? I've evolved. I understand that some consultants, I said some are worth the time and energy and really know their stuff. The team that you put together, 11FS, so that's a good example, right? When you put together, this is why I'm known as the nicest guy, because I suck up.
Flattery gets you
everywhere. Yes, but it's true, right? When you get a small core group of folks that really know what they're doing, and there's really not a weak link, you're going to do extremely well. And that's what I saw with Carlisle and Gallagher at the time, which then was acquired by NTT. It's the same type of thing. Specialists, really, really good at what they do, strong backgrounds, and you bring a lot of value. So I've had a good run. It's been fun.
It's an interesting one, isn't it? When you sort of flip into that, most organizations are brand-led. And actually, increasingly, the industry is moving to reputation. So it's the reputation of the individuals rather than necessarily the reputation of the organization. And I think a lot of organizations are struggling with that. You know, it's the idea of Man United being bigger than any of the players. And that's fine until you have Cristiano Ronaldo playing, right? And then actually some of the players are going to be slightly bigger reputations than the club in itself. So. But what are you doing at NTT now? How are you working there?
Well, more importantly, why'd you use a Man U analogy? I mean, I don't understand that whatsoever. God.
No, maybe not
so
these
many
days.
Other teams we could have gone with.
Well, where I live in Norwich, I don't know, international audience wouldn't know Norwich City at all.
So I do, and by the way, Norwich City beat Arsenal last year, and Dave never shut up about it forever and a day. I agree. I think we're reflecting, I'm going to go historical now, the Renaissance period, when it did went back to individual talent, mm-hmm. right? And that meant so much outside the organization. I think we're seeing that in our industry, thank God. I think it's much, much needed. It's a breath of fresh air in what we're doing. And I think finding those individual talents, especially in this day and age, due to social and just the very way we network, you can do that now. I don't think 10 years ago you could have pulled that off. Yeah. You know, you were David at Gartner, you were David at Lloyd's. There was no way you could build up a reputation like that. And so I think we live in a golden age. I'm thrilled with what we have. And it's interesting for me, because now, you know, you just mentioned it, I was with a small consultancy firm, maybe 800 folks. Now I work for NTT, which acquired my company. It's 270,000 employees, 90 countries. Yeah, massive.
Yeah.
And yet, they leave me, I don't want to say they leave me alone. They give me a lot of bandwidth. They've made it very clear within the company that I'm slightly unique. I think that's a nice way of saying he's a pain in the ass. But they're really good about it. They're smart, and they recognize that there are folks like that. I think 10 years ago, 15 years ago, even in your career, you probably saw this. If you tried to pull off what you and I do, we'd be gone. They would have shown us the door a long time ago. Now you have to protect those resources. And too many companies aren't. There's too much talent leaving the banks.
It's a difficult one though, but you have to earn that trust, don't you?
Yes.
I think that's the thing. And it's, you know, either through things that you've done or places that you've worked, you've kind of gained that credibility. You've gained the nicest guy in fintech reputation. That actually means you have that latitude to sort of take, they can take that risk on you because of the experience that you've got, I think.
And I don't think it has anything to do with age or time in the business. So let's take Simon, for example. So I worked with Simon Taylor at Thesis. We both came out of there. Simon is nowhere near 50. I don't think Simon's near 30 yet, is he? He's quickly approaching it.
Yeah.
But it's easy to look at Simon and see the talent there. Who's the guy that is the president of Loot? Ollie. Ollie's 23?
Yeah, amazing.
And I'd put him on any team in a heartbeat.
Yeah.
So I don't think it has anything to do with age. It has to do with what you've been able to do and accomplish. And to me, that just means so much more. And I think if especially large organizations, I'm not going to say banks, it's also the processors, it's the solution providers, it's the, you know, experience, it's the others of the world. They have to be smart and not lose that talent. Because they are, left and right.
Well, arguably, you know, this is what we sort of say about fintech. You know, it's not just disrupting the bank, it's disrupting everything in the value chain. You know, it's the reason why people like us exist, is because we can now. You know, if, like you say, 10 years ago, a small company going up against a large one for doing it, you wouldn't hear of it. You know, a bank wouldn't even entertain it. But that's the place that we're in now. People are looking for solid alternatives to, you know, the way in which it's been done before, which is good news for everybody, really. It's choice is always a good thing, isn't it?
Yeah, I agree completely. It's an industry that needs a reboot, majorly. It's going to be a very tough industry to get a reboot on. I am getting ready to do a keynote in a couple days. And I reached out to a bunch of folks asking them for their input on payments and what they think the biggest change is going to be. And I asked Dave for this, and his reply was nothing, which I thought was the most honest answer ever. Meaning, from a large scale player, it's going to be very difficult to get anything done. Yeah. For the smaller, nimble players, they're going to do a lot in a good way and impact the industry and help out the larger players.
Yeah.
We'll see a lot of adoption of what they're able to do. So again, I think we live in a golden time. I mean, we really, really do. Now, if we don't, as humans, get in the way of that, so I'm going to go on a little riff here. You read a lot about AI, right? And this whole notion of when will it become self-aware? You have the Elon Musk camp, right? And where they could wipe us out, or it could wipe us out. Yeah. And I never really subscribed to that theory until this year. Now, I think. Thank you, England, for Brexit, and you're welcome for Trump, everyone. So now I do start to wonder if AI is going to look at us and say, "You people make as a species don't make any sense."
Yeah, it's a funny one, isn't it? We spoke about this on a show we did maybe like 5 or 6 episodes ago, but you know, the idea that actually artificial intelligence has to learn from somebody, and is humanity actually the best people to be teaching the best way of behaving? You know, it's like a bad parent trying to teach a child how to act. It doesn't work out very well in terms of doing things, does it?
So the EQ side, the emotional side, the idea of reading to AI children's stories, right? Which I think is brilliant, and we need to do, because there's that emotional connection, and the EQ component of what we do, which we've learned over time, is incredibly important, right? How well do you work with the team? Empathy, that's a skill I've had to learn over the past 30 years. Because again, when I started out, I was horrible. I was an ass. And I can reflect on that and see that now. But I've learned that over time. And how we build that into our technology solutions, we have to. We see that with driverless cars, right? What decision are you gonna make? Do you save the one, do you save the many? Those type of decisions, we have to build into it, right?
Yeah.
And I think that's it's Pandora's box.
So now you get to travel the world and, you know, talk to fun people at fun conferences, and that's an amazing career, right? And, you know, from the, you know, depths of the sea in a submarine to sort of traveling the world to lovely places like London and Barcelona to do presentations. It's a good cycle, right?
I call it being an evangelist. And there's quite a few of us, I think, that fall into that category. Chris Skinner does. You know, there's several that do that, and I think we need that. We need folks that give a reality check on both sides, though. I think it gets pushed too much just on the banking side. You also need to do a reality check. We're at level 39 right now, and you know, the place is packed. But I think there's some elderly advice that we can give a lot of folks here too, right? I think it goes both sides to give them to paint the picture of how well this can work. how much I personally believe in this. I'm thrilled to see how much Level 39 has changed over just the past couple of years. I'm thrilled to see the career of my friends change so much. I think I enjoy that more than anything. That's on my LinkedIn profile, I think. I stole a line from an author named Dan Pink, which is, you know, if you could summarize yourself in one sentence, what would it be? And mine was, striving to make change in other people, which I like.
That's nice.
Yeah, I stole it from him. I didn't come up with it whatsoever, but I love the concept of it, right? And I'm learning that the older I get, that's the more I want to do. Maybe it's because I have a lot of kids. I have four kids. I got a three-year-old granddaughter, and I'll show pictures later. They'll be available on the podcast notes. You'll see those. But I believe that's incredibly important, is how much change you can help be a catalyst for in other folks.
But increasingly, what we're sort of finding actually in the work that we're doing is the major change isn't through technology. It isn't about AI. It's about people. And exactly. It's about how you change the mentality or the culture of an organization manifests itself through what it actually then delivers to a customer. So, you know, you have to start, you know, it feels very Michael Jackson on us here, but, you know, you've kind of got to start with the man in the mirror, haven't you, in terms of things that are going on there.
So, and that's a challenge, right? Because the tech always changes. Mm. The people, not so much. Actually, it's the same problems. We always, you know, it's egos. It's, you know, the concept of jealousy that comes in there. It's all the basic human elements that have been around for thousands of years. Hasn't changed, yet the technology is changing at a pace that is unbelievable. Mm. And how do you marry those two up? I think that's the biggest challenge.
Yeah, it's very tough. What are the big things that you've been involved in is the femtech movement. You've obviously been a kind of a big advocate for you know, interviewing and really sort of shining a light on key female players in both the technology and the banking industry. How did you get involved in that? And I guess, you know, you've talked to some amazing people looking through the list of, you know, interviews that you've done. So, you know, are there any key trends that you see coming out from them?
Sure. How I got into that is I'm incredibly lazy. That's the truth. I was asked to write a white paper by Swift for Sibos, for Intertribe, back in Singapore, I think it was 2015. Mm-hmm. And I hate to write white papers. I hate to read white papers. I hate everything about white papers. But I wanted to go to Singapore, and I like InnoTribe. Mm-hmm. I like the concept of it. Yeah. So I said yes, was able to co-author the paper with a friend of mine. So we looked at diversity in the industry. And I'm going to be blunt. It was an opportunity for me to go to Singapore and to do InnoTribe. So I selfishly said yes. Then I started doing research, and then I thought, oh, this is actually really bad. I hadn't paid any attention to it. And the numbers were horrific. What I saw was horrific. But one thing that we did in the white paper I thought was brilliant was we just didn't give an opinion. We talked to, I think, 10 or 15 women across different parts of financial services to get their feedback and across multiple continents. And we saw some consistency in their message. The white paper went really well, and Peter Vanderauer had asked me to do a second follow-up before Sibos, and I just didn't have any time. And I said, what if I just do a couple more interviews? That'll be easy. I've done 357, wow. I think, interviews in a year and a half.
That is impressive.
Isn't that
that's
crazy?
Commitment.
That's
right?
Nuts. Yeah. And that's on the side. That's at night, weekends, just, you know, but I enjoy it. It's something, the more I started doing it, the more fun it got. Mm-hmm. And we've created an entire website dedicated to this now. Gela Boscovich, who's a good friend of mine, was one of the women I interviewed, lives here in London now. She's really taken it to where we now have meetups. When I leave here, I'm going there to meet a ton of the individuals I've interviewed to actually meet them for the first time. Which I can't wait. So like Starling Bank, Ann Bowden will be there. Mm-hmm. I've been able to interview Blythe Masters, which I thought was really cool. Leslie Berlin, who's now the CMO at Twitter, mm-hmm. used to be with Amex. So yeah, it's really been, I'm about to interview a refugee that is running to be the president of Somalia.
Wow.
How cool is that?
Yeah,
just through introduction. That's actually the one I'm probably looking forward to more than anything. Mm-hmm. I interviewed the young lady who introduced Bitcoin into Afghanistan. It's got a price on her head. I mean, just, you know, individuals that inspire me. Mm. So I've loved doing that. I'm incredibly lazy. I don't do any editing. I interview them. They write, they give it to me. I copy and paste. So again, it seems really like I'm a really nice guy. Yeah. I am a lazy ass. I'm not doing anything. But I enjoy it. It's really fun. I say the biggest thing I learned is that this is one of the most complicated messes there is, and there is no easy solution. Mm. When we talk about diversity in the workplace, there's not one simple answer. It's education, it's talking about it, it's acknowledging it exists. I think that's the best place to start. And if you don't believe that if you don't think diversity in the workplace is an issue, go read any write-up on this. Don't read the write-up, read the comments. Just go right to the trolls and read that, and then you'll go, okay, yeah. Or look at the American election. Yeah. Sorry.
Well, yeah, I was gonna maybe mention that next, actually, because it would be a shame to have you here without mentioning it. But welcome to the pain, essentially.
Thank you. We've
sort of had the change curve, which is called Brexit, and we're on the other side of that slightly, I guess. But you guys are probably in the midst of it now.
Yeah, thank you for Nigel Farage. God.
You're welcome. You can have him.
Yes, thanks. Thank you so much for that. I was absolutely amazed that Brexit went through. I was doing a radio show that day, and Simon was on. He's one of the guests. And I was talking to him as this occurred, and I said, I see that you're having some bad weather. Do you think that's going to impact this? And Simon laughed, and said, no, I think we'll be fine. And I was flying back on a plane to the States that night, and I remember watching the news unfold, and I thought, what's happening to my adopted country in the UK? And then our election took place. We'll see what comes of it. I'm in pain. I don't know else to say. It hurts me as an individual. And again, I think as I'm getting older, the empathetic part of me really hurts. Let's see how bad it gets. The state of the world today does make me nervous. France, I think, will be the next to potentially fall with their leadership. And then you look at the UN Security Council, the five individuals that will be running that don't align with my values whatsoever. That's tough.
I think that's the scary thing, isn't it? The Brexit piece that we found probably hardest to understand was there was half of the country who thought so significantly different to us. I think the Trump piece terrifies me, but 4 years from now, he will be history. He won't get reelected. I wouldn't have thought he would have been but actually it's the awakening that actually half of a huge country thinks completely different to the other half. And that's quite a terrifying proposition, isn't it? It's a challenging democracy moment in terms of where we are. It's a huge thing.
Well, I think it has a big impact on our industry. I talked to Dan Kimmerling, who's with Silicon Valley Bank. Dan, literally a genius. He's a member of Mensa. I found that out last week. I didn't know that. And we had a long conversation about this. And I personally think that, especially in the U.S., one, we do live in bubbles on all sides. Mm-hmm. Social media helps drive that because you only get your point of view. And you can filter that to no end. And that's incredibly dangerous, is not being exposed to how other people think and talk to them. But I think Silicon Valley's in for a rude awakening in that they're going to be made out to be the enemy somewhat. And I don't think it's their fault whatsoever. But part of what Trump was able to run on was on the idea of creating jobs. And he's never going to be able to deliver on that, not so much just the rhetoric he took, just technology. AI. The advances we're doing, chatbots, you take your pick, they're going to replace so many jobs. Truck drivers in the U.S. accounts for 8 million jobs. That's going to be gone. Mercedes already has the trucks to do the long haul. That's 8 million jobs in just one category. We already talked about how banking's going to be disrupted, bank tellers, that whole concept, loan officers. We'll see those jobs disappear. What do you replace it with? I do believe they will be replaced with something, but that requires training, that requires education, and it also requires acknowledging that event's going to take place. So we're going to go through a massive shift in how we work and the types of jobs that we need to do, and we're ignoring it to no end. And I do think that Silicon Valley, Silicon Alley in New York, I think London, to some degree you become the enemy. And I think that's sad. I really do. Mm.
It's hard to put the sort of genie back in the bottle.
Oh, that it's one, not isn't happening. It? It's,
yeah. And I think we've almost, we've started on the inevitable path of, what is humanity good for, really, in terms of where we are?
Well, I think it'll make our leadership interesting in the future, because I would love to see some leadership come out of the tech community. Hmm. I would love to see that take place. And I think you're going to have to be incredibly tech savvy to be a leader. To some degree, President Obama was. A lot of people have talked about him going into venture capital. Bloomberg is another example of that, Mayor Bloomberg. I think we're going to see some leadership come out of the tech space. And I don't think that's a bad thing. I think you do need to understand that and not belittle it and, go and say you're going to bring factory jobs back to the Rust Belt in the U.S. It's never going to happen. Hmm. It will not happen. If that factory does come back, it's going to be robotics. What jobs did that replace?
We need to get so advanced with technology we can go back in time. I think that's the statement, isn't it?
So. Well, it gets back to, how do you do potentially a guaranteed income? What do you do? I mean, there's a lot that we need to take a look at from a social impact on what society's going to be like for our kids. Hmm. I'm 50, so you know, quality of life is going up, so I'll probably be around. But what about all my kids? What's their life going to be like?
Yeah.
I am definitely pushing, you know, the STEM studies for them. I'm pushing it, but it's their choice if they want to go into it or not. But I think that's incredibly important to be able to go down that path. And it makes me slightly nervous for the future.
On that note.
Don't you love that? And that's why I'm going to go drink a whole lot tonight. Get soused.
So one of the things that you've been doing quite a lot of, obviously, off the back of the all of the interviews that you've been doing with FemTech, is now the podcast. So FinTech 5, how did that come about?
Well, mainly because I like the sound of my own voice. Narcissistic. When I was doing all the interviews for the FemTech leader part of that, what I enjoyed the most about it was the actual interview itself. They were either, you know, face-to-face or over the phone, and I just enjoyed that process immensely. And then I realized I hadn't really captured any of those outside of a print form. It's a WordPress site. And I was tossing around the idea of a podcast. You know, I've done a couple of the radio shows, and I enjoy that part in the FinTech community. And so I came up with the idea of a podcast that fit within my framework from a work standpoint and time standpoint. So I thought, what if I did a short form, only 5 minutes? Because I listen to podcasts like crazy, and I have a way of doing that. So I listen to you guys on long drives or flights or everything else, because that's an hour, hour and a half. The same with like Breaking Banks or others. I've cut my grass to that. But a short form, only a 5 minute podcast, I don't know anybody that's doing that that's not on a micro topic.
Sure.
So I thought, what if I just did short interviews, kind of based on my ADHD and how spastic I am, and how much could I shove into 5 minutes? So, and that was the hardest part, was how long would the interview be?
Yep.
Did I do 7 minutes? Did I do 10 minutes? And I went with five because it had an F in it, and it fit FinTech. So it sounded great. And what I've found is you can shove a lot into 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. You really can. And it's a lot of fun. So I've thoroughly enjoyed doing it. I take moments of opportunity to do that. If I see somebody I know, I said, and it's easy to sell, right? Yeah. Dave, I only need 5 minutes. You don't have to do any prep. I want you to laugh. I want you to cuss. I want you to be yourself. It's pure 5 minutes, unfiltered, very raw, but to get insights on the individual. And I love that. How much information can you pull out in 5 minutes? That's actually a lot harder than doing, you know, a long form interview.
Prep, focus, it's good.
Yeah.
But it's great. You know, I really enjoyed the listen. So guys, definitely check that out in terms of what Sam's doing. So Sam, thank you very much for joining us. Really appreciate it.